Welcome to the sixth podcast in the series on brain development, mental health, and addiction. The series can be accessed via afmc.ca. Throughout this presentation, we will be hearing from some of the leading experts on brain development and addiction medicine from across Canada and the United States, as well as case studies and personal testimonials from professionals struggling with addiction. The podcast will also include a series of reflective questions that will link the specific learning objectives with the Medical Council of Canada objectives for the qualifying examination related to addiction. The MCC objectives are organized around physicians' roles as defined by the CanMeds and CanMeds FMU competency frameworks for undergraduate medical education. Today's topic will be an introduction to brain plasticity and behavioral change. We will talk about the process of brain plasticity and its influence on behaviors, how pruning is the key mechanism that leads to experiences making such an impact on brain architecture, and how the effects of these factors are cumulative and can gain momentum, for good or bad, as one gets older and goes through life. To begin, what do we mean by brain plasticity? Well, brain plasticity refers to the brain's capacity to change as a result of our lived experience, or in other words, from input from the environment. Brain circuits are built in a bottom-up sequence over the course of the developmental period. The brain is most plastic during the early period of development, meaning that during this time it's the most vulnerable to harm as well as the most capable of recovery. As brain circuits stabilize as we grow older, they become increasingly difficult to alter. Early brain development involves a complex dance of genetic and environmental events that interact to adapt the brain to fit a particular environmental context. Behaviors emerge in development as the brain structures underlying specific capacities mature over time. This development represents more than a simple unfolding of a genetic blueprint, as gene expression can be changed by environmental factors. For example, more complex cognitive functions rely on late maturing structures, and therefore many behavioral capacities don't emerge until later in adolescence. Dr. Charles Nelson from the Children's Hospital in Boston describes neuroplasticity and how experience makes its way into the structure of our brains.
Does the structure of experience work its way into the structure of the brain, and if so, how? And we think of this as neuroplasticity. We know that the impact of experience on the brain is not constant throughout life. Early experience often exerts a particularly strong influence in shaping the functional properties of the immature brain. Many neural connections pass through a period of development when the capacity for experience-driven modification is greater than it is in adulthood, and these phases are referred to as sensitive or critical periods. Language skills, emotional responses, social behavior, as well as sensory and motor capacities are shaped powerfully and permanent by early experience. Let me give you an example of this without slides. For the past decade, two colleagues and I have been doing a randomized clinical trial of foster care as an intervention for early institutionalization. And we're doing this in Bucharest, Romania. And the storyline here is that Romania has a long history of institutionalizing children that have been abandoned at birth. And rather than just do a study looking at the effects of institutionalization, we actually did an intervention study. And the way this worked is that we had a large number of kids who had been abandoned to institutions at birth. We did an extensive baseline assessment on them when they were babies. And then we randomly assigned half to a foster care intervention that we built and half stayed in the institution. And then we have a third group of kids who live with their families in the community. It's known as the Bucharest Early Intervention Project, and I suspect a few of you are familiar with this. We've been studying these kids now all this time. We just finished an eight-year assessment, and I learned last week we've been given a grant from the NIH to see these kids as they make the transition to adolescence, which is really critical. The most important thing to come out of this work is the ability to identify sensitive periods in development. So, for example, when it comes to IQ, the children placed in foster care before the age of two had on average, 8 IQ points more than those placed after 2. In fact, the kids placed after 2 had IQs that were identical to the kids who never left the institution, which was about 75. And moreover, if they were placed closer to 18 months, their IQs were pushing 90. So that's a huge difference between 75 and 90.
So experiences can alter the structure of our brains, and this in turn results in behavioral changes as we grow older. But what are the key experiences during childhood development? And how do these experiences make a difference? Dr. Brian Cobb, a professor of psychology and neuroscience at the University of Lethbridge, explains.
What kinds of things could you encounter prenatally or preconceptually that would make a difference? So I've got the list here: sounds, touch, light, food, and so on. Thoughts. Thoughts are interesting because if you have a thought today that you can remember tomorrow, your thought must have changed your brain. Because the only way you can remember something is that there's some change in the brain. So thinking can change your brain. And if you think about that for a second as to how you get into this downward spiral in disorders like depression, negative thinking and whatnot, the more you do it, the more you change the brain in this downward spiral. So these sort of things are subtle, but they're real. But when we talk about sounds or touch, light and so on, these things we can actually manipulate in the lab, and we can show you that it makes a huge difference. Now, you've seen this list of stages of brain development. Chuck talked about them: cell birth, migration, differentiation, and so on. This is occurring. We can alter brain development by experiences at virtually any one of these places. So if we alter migration and cells migrate to the wrong place, we can get epilepsy. We can have these cells that are anomalous and don't belong where they are and they cause trouble. We can actually alter neurogenesis. We can manipulate neurogenesis, increase it or decrease it, which is going to alter the brain. It turns out that to get from a monkey brain to a human brain doesn't require a lot of extra cell divisions. So if you think about it, you're starting with one cell and then two and then four and blah, 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 right? At some point, when you double the number of divisions, you're getting a huge change. So you could actually manipulate the number of cell divisions and produce a big difference in the brain that you got.
So what is the key mechanism that leads to experiences making such an impact on brain architecture? The answer is that experience dictates which neurons are retained and which neurons are pruned away. Dr. Thomas Boyce is a professor of pediatrics at the University of British Columbia. Here he details the process of pruning.
We're learning that experience shapes brain architecture by overproduction of neurons and synapses, followed by what's known as pruning, the cutting back of numbers of neurons and the numbers of synapses. So here's a typical array of neurons at birth. Here is this proliferative, exuberant overproduction of neurons and synapses at age 6 years, but look what happens by 14 years of age. There's a thinning out and, if you will, a kind of sophistication, an emerging complexity that involves not only production but also retreat in the development of synapses and neurons. We're also finding from work of a variety of investigators that there are developmental changes in the proportion of gray and white matter over time.
Dr. Cobb likens this pruning process to a sculptor and his work chiseling down a piece of rock.
The metaphor I like to use is Michelangelo is making David, the statue of David, and he doesn't get a dump truck of sand and a bunch of glue and put it together. What he does is he starts with a block of stone and he starts chiseling away the stuff he doesn't need. Now, he could have made Madonna, he could have made David, he could have made anything, depending on how he used those chisels. The chisels are hormones and experiences. The preconceptual chisels are the kind of stone that it is, so that you have one kind of stone or another kind of stone. So the idea here is that the brain is being sculpted. Now, the problem that Nancy pointed out quite correctly, and I hadn't thought about it, was that it implies that once David's made, you can't change it anymore. And that's not true. And so we can keep using these chisels. The point is, though, we can alter the structure of David and make him look like a 20-year-old man versus a 60-year-old man. It's going to be a little different, but it's going to be little chisels. And so the changes aren't going to be quite so dramatic as they are to get to the original sculpture. But that's the idea.
It's important to note that a wide range of prenatal and postnatal factors influence this pruning process and brain plasticity during our early developmental years. Some well-researched factors include alcohol, the effects of sensory and motor stimulation, psychoactive drugs taken by the mother or child, This could be both illicit drugs and prescription medications, stress, gonadal hormones, attachment, social experiences, and food. The effects of these factors are cumulative and gain momentum, for good or bad, as one gets older and goes through life. Thus, early experiences contribute to an evolving developmental trajectory for each child that can influence brain functioning long afterwards. This is because if brain architecture is changed, especially in the frontal regions, the brain will function differently and respond to future experiences in an altered manner. Dr. Cobb elaborates.
If you change the structure of frontal regions, it means it's going to function differently, and it means that you're going to respond to other experiences differently. So imagine this. If I give you prenatally stress, or prenatally nicotine, or prenatally tactile stimulation, it's altering frontal lobe development. It means that the way I interact with the world is now different. And that means it's going to feed back on itself, and it means that my brain's going to develop differently because I'm interacting with the world in a different way.
Finally, it's important to highlight one final factor in brain plasticity. The ability to change brain architecture and behavior decreases over time. It's both important and more efficient, therefore, to get things right the first time, or design interventions that will reach the individual during childhood and adolescence. This not only is important for the individual, but also pays dividends for the well-being of society. Dr. Judy Cameron, a professor of physiology and pharmacology at the University of Pittsburgh, explains.
Brain plasticity, the ability to change behavior, decreases over time. Brain circuits stabilize with age, making them increasingly more difficult to alter. The window of opportunity for development remains open, and you saw that in cognitive development. You were building circuits through much of childhood, and then through much of the teenage years, you're still having pruning. So you're still having influence, but the number of circuits that remain open like that is fewer. A lot happens early. It is more difficult, both biologically and economically, to get things right the first time than try to fix them later. Why economically? Well, you can imagine that if it's more difficult to learn and you don't have as much brain plasticity, that a lot more effort, a lot more teacher effort, a lot more societal effort is going to go in to teaching something later. And that's going to cost more money. So a better use of dollars is to put the dollars into early childhood.
So here's a summary of the key points in this podcast. Early brain development involves a complex dance of genetic and environmental events that interact to adapt the brain to fit a particular environmental context. A wide range of prenatal and postnatal factors influence this process and brain plasticity during our early developmental years. If brain architecture is changed, especially in the frontal regions, the brain will function differently and respond to future experiences in an altered manner. The ability to change brain architecture and behavior decreases over time, so early interventions are important to minimize the damage from toxic stress. So as we reach the end of this podcast, here are some reflective questions on the origins of addiction. They are based on the CanMeds competencies and address how you will deal with addiction in your practice. 1. In your role as a medical student or practicing physician, how will you integrate and apply this new knowledge on brain plasticity and behavioral change? Does it give you hope for ongoing growth and development, even if the level of plasticity diminishes over time? What are the implications for recovery from addiction? Do you think brain rehab principles would be applicable to addiction recovery? 2. How do you think children who have been subjected to early toxic stress might present? 3. How would you assist or advocate for children who are subjected to early toxic stress? What supports do you think children, adolescents, and adults might require to mitigate the impacts? We hope that you've enjoyed this podcast on brain plasticity and behavioral change. We welcome your comments in the feedback section at the bottom of this webpage, and we invite you to continue exploring this series as we examine in more detail the core concepts of early childhood development, as well as the types, causes, and treatment of addiction. This podcast series is based on lectures from the Alberta Family Wellness Initiative, a knowledge mobilization initiative designed to translate scientific research into policy and practice. The podcasts were developed by the Association of Faculties of Medicine of Canada with guidance from a project advisory committee and produced by Hugh Kellum and Colin McDonald at the University of Ottawa. Narration was done by Hugh Kellum. This project was sponsored by the Norlene Foundation. The complete podcast series can be accessed via afmc.ca.